Now, without any further wasting time, may I request Professor Tilak for his keynote address. Sir, Gulwam rang bhare badno bahar chale, chale bhi aao ki gulshan ka karwar chale. Sir.
I indeed feel a great privilege and an honor to be here. I came to this university several times, thanks to my friends here in the academic staff college and also others, including former vice chancellor. But I feel it a very special occasion today, and I'm indeed grateful to the university authorities, Professor Shahid, who is the vice chancellor, and also Dr. Shahid, who is in the social work and who is coordinating it, for inviting me to come and initiate the discussion on an important theme. Madam Chairperson, Professor Amina Kishore, Mr. Rasul Khan, Dr. Shahid, Professor Amina Tahseen, and many experts in the group. In fact, many I recognize and some I do not recognize, that's my weakness. Professor Rahman, Professor Khatija Begum, Dr. Jakir Hussain, and many, many experts from the public institutions and also from NGOs who are actively involved in the area of education. I'm particularly glad that the Ministry of Human Resource Development has asked Maulana Azad University to initiate nationwide consultation on this important theme of inequalities between social groups in higher education. And I think this is one of the series of consultations that will happen in this campus and also in the country as a whole towards the formulation of the new national policy on education. The first national policy, not the first, the last national policy was formulated in 1986 with some revisions in 1992. And this becomes really a radical, perhaps at least it can be expected to be a radically different policies given the increasingly changing socio-economic and political context, both in the country and at the international level. And hence I feel the consultations of this kind would be of immense significance in the formulation of the new policy. I may go a little bit beyond the theme that was given to me, that it's about, say, specifically about social groups and gender and social groups in higher education and inequalities between them, because social inequalities are also related to economic inequalities. So I refer to larger set of inequalities in education rather than between different groups of population, how they are related. I would also go a little bit beyond the mandate in the sense that this is expected to be a discussion on higher education, but I would refer to some aspects, but not really very extensively, but highlight the point that the discussion cannot be exclusive on higher education, because higher education is critically dependent upon the school education sector as well. So I will not go really violate the whole boundaries of the discussion, but go a little bit beyond it, and do permit me. Just one second. It's very important to note that the provision of good quality education is the most important equalizer in the society. In fact, for a very long period, we have been discussing about equality and also quality in education, essentially with primary education and then with secondary education. But we must really go beyond school education, because the inequalities at higher levels of education are much higher than inequalities in school education. And with universal elementary education now nearly more than 90% enrollment rates, the inequalities in school education, elementary education are much smaller. So there is a need to go into higher education quite significantly and with a very clear focus. It's also important to note that educational inequalities cannot be discussed in isolation, because educational inequalities and inequalities in the society are very, very closely related to each other. In one sense, the educational inequalities contribute to inequalities in the society as a whole, inequalities in this, from the social point of view and also from the economic point of view, and also, in fact, in the political arenas. And these unique socio-economic and political inequalities will in turn contribute to inequalities in education system. It's a cycle. And that's very important. It's both ways, they are very strong related. So in fact, it's a chain of inequalities that you find. And if you look at the several components of the chain, the inequalities in education contribute to inequalities in the labor market in terms of inequalities in employment, information employment. Who is operating? You are operating. Okay, can go to the next one. Okay. Inequalities in the access to labor market information and also employment opportunities, which will in turn contribute to inequalities in economic sphere, particularly in terms of earnings, and which will have, of course, a very strong effect on the socio-economic and political inequalities, which in turn will contribute to educational inequalities. And she says it's a cycle. And where to break the cycle is a very important one. And there is a good amount of research that goes further, says that if you aim at breaking this cycle, focusing on education, next one, it will be very good, in the sense that that will be the most powerful and most effective way of breaking the chain of inequalities. As it is inequalities in education that really promotes social mobility, that will promote occupational mobility, that will promote economic mobility in the larger sense. And between different levels of education, it's also very clearly recognized that higher education is the real engine for development in all spheres, socio, economic, political, occupational, and other areas. There is also a large-scale international research which shows that among the several measures that aim at reducing inequalities in the society, including anti-poverty programs of direct cash transfers, etc., education becomes the most powerful instrument and most sustainable instrument for development. While other measures may not necessarily contribute to sustainable reduction in inequalities, education would be able to help in sustaining the achieved equalities in the society in a very, very significant sense. It's also important to note that the inequalities in education are really costly to the whole society, not only to the individuals' economic welfare, individual social welfare, but also to the whole society. The whole society suffers very severely if certain groups of population do not have meaningful and good level of education. And there is again a large amount of research to show to say that. Apart from the point that educational inequalities would itself contribute to the really weakening of the educational system itself with no diversity in the system. That's the reason why we have recently recognized diversity as an important plus point of higher educational systems, and UGC at one point also tried to give additional grants based upon some definition of diversity index. Even though that was very narrowly defined, but I think that still, I feel, is a good beginning of recognizing the diversity in education and rewarding diversity in higher education institutions. There is also a sizable amount of research evidence, both in India and abroad, which show very clearly that the economic benefits from education are much higher for the weaker sections of the society, scheduled castes, scheduled tribes, religious minorities, gender-wise women, and rural population compared to the counterparts. The society's whole economic benefits would be much larger. And given that, you very, very clearly find that the argument against any measure of promoting equalities in the society, like the reservations, would affect efficiency or would affect merit in the system is not a tenable argument. The gains that we get from the whole society because of improving equality in the educational system would compensate if there are any small short-term losses that also that may gain because of these reservation and other affirmative action policies. That's very important to note that. Now, what I'm going to discuss in the next 20-25 minutes, the time that's given to me is, or less than 25 minutes, because I already taken about 5 minutes or so, is with the help of some statistics. I will not give really a lot of statistics, but I think statistics are important. They tell us lots of interesting things. I will say what kind of inequalities exist and what is the level and degree of inequalities between different groups of population focusing on higher education. And between what group, between different groups, which are the groups which are performing better in terms of improving educational status and thereby reducing inequalities in the society. And what I do is, I said I go by the groups between different, between of course obviously gender, men and women, between scheduled castes, scheduled tribes, and some reference to the other backward classes on which we don't have really long information. And inequalities between different religious groups, particularly Hindus and Muslims, even though we refer to the other groups also, the Christians, etc., who are much more advanced educationally. Inequalities between rural and urban regions, and in a country like India, interstate inequalities and regional inequalities are very important. And lastly, inequalities between the poor and the rich, economically the poor and the rich. And I try to look at them with the help of some reasonably strong database that India has collected over long years. And certainly social scientists know the national sample survey data that I use. And I refer to certain important dimensions. Unfortunately, until now, the policy concentration has been on improving inequalities between scheduled castes and scheduled castes, scheduled types, and other non-scheduled population. And it is only very, very recently we got aware of the problem between religious minorities and the religiously backward section, religiously forward sections of the society, particularly Hindus and Muslims. But we relatively neglected the two other dimensions, the regional inequalities, which used to be an important dimension of public policy for a very long period. But since the mid-70s onwards, we ignored the regional dimension, regional balance development as a goal in our planning process. And we neglected much more severely the inequalities between the poor and the rich. Now, I have done quite a little bit seriously. In fact, that's the paper that Dr. Shahid has referred to, which came in Social Change recently. Looked at these four important dimensions of higher education in terms of quantitative indicators. The enrollment ratio in higher education, which is out of the population of the age group, how many students, how many people are going into higher education system, is one which is a very standard indicator on which we have extensive data and reasonably reliable, strong, sound database exists. And instead of taking the total population of that particular age group, like 18 to 23, better you take the secondary school graduates or pass outs of the secondary school system who are eligible for higher education. So you refine the enrollment ratio to consider eligible enrollment ratio as an important one that also I have seen. And see the transition rate between higher secondary education and higher levels of education. On this, we have continuous year-wise data for a very long period. What I also have considered is, out of the total stock of population in the country, how many people are higher educated, particularly in terms of census kind of data, which are also collected by National Sample Survey. Among the adult population, how many people are higher educated, which is also a very important indicator. As I said, I have seen all these four dimensions quite seriously and I don't say thoroughly, but reasonably satisfactorily. But for the time being, I'll focus on just one important aspect or two important aspects, as I found results are more or less similar. But since many of you are going to discuss policy issues quite seriously, I think it's important to recognize those four dimensions. One, very, very quickly, some statistics. You find that the enrollment ratio of women in higher education has increased by more than three times, from 6.6 to 18.74% between 93-94 and 2009-10, on which we have reasonably comparable data. And we also find that the inequality has reduced in the sense that women's enrollment ratio compared to the men's enrollment ratio has relatively declined over the years. It's not given here, but we find with the latest statistics suggest that more than 40% of our students in higher education are women, which is a very sizable, important indicator. It's a different issue. It's also an important one, but a different issue that which are the disciplines in which women are going and which are the disciplines. Some women, some disciplines are concentrated by women and some disciplines are not enrolled at all by women students. But I'll also sum up the table very, very quickly into one or two lines. The enrollment ratios of both men and women have improved quite significantly. And women as a percentage of the total enrollments have improved quite significantly over the years. Not only between 93, 94 and 2010, but if you look at over 50-51 to today, it's much more significant, impressive improvement. Second, if you look at by caste group, the scheduled tribes enrollment ratio has increased from less than 4 to nearly 12% between these years. And the enrollment ratio of scheduled calls also increased by more than three times, from 4.3 to 14.8%. And we also find, relatively speaking, the enrollments, the inequalities between scheduled tribe and non-scheduled tribe population has come down quite significantly. And though the inequality between scheduled caste and non-scheduled caste population has also declined, but the scheduled tribe population's inequalities, much more steep decline could be found. So in a sense, we find significant improvement in the enrollment ratios of all groups, scheduled caste, scheduled tribes. But the relative improvement with respect to scheduled tribes is very, very fast. But scheduled caste also have made significant improvement, even though still we find that scheduled caste enrollment ratio is much less than the enrollment ratio of non-scheduled population, and scheduled tribe enrollment ratio is much less than non-scheduled population. Third, on religion, in fact, which was less extensively researched in the public policy arena today, in education in particular, we find that the enrollment ratio of Hindus have increased by four times, from 6.3% to 24.2%. While that of the Muslims have increased slightly faster, in fact, from 3.4 to 13.8, by more than four times again during this period. And of course, as I said, Christians are highly advanced in terms of educational status for a very long period for various historical and contemporary reasons. But also perhaps for historical and contemporary reasons, the Muslims lagged behind quite significantly in the higher education system. And if you look at inequalities between these groups of population, Hindus and Muslims particularly, and what we find is there is improvement in the rate of the enrollment of the Muslim population, but the improvement is very, very small. Like the inequality coefficient has come down. Rather, the Hindus were 1.85%, 1.85 times better in 93-94, or the reverse. The Muslims were so much less forward. Today, the Hindus are only 1.75 times better than the Muslims, which means that Muslims have slightly improved, but the improvement is very, very small, particularly if you compare this improvement with the scheduled caste enrollment, scheduled tribes enrollments. So again, to sum up these religious groups, we find that all religions have improved in terms of their gross enrollment ratios. And obviously, Christians are ahead of all other population, including Hindus, Muslims, Sikhs, and others. In fact, some details were also given in the paper. And the growth is the fastest among the Christians. But inequalities between Hindus and Muslims is still an important issue. They have diminished, but not really much. And it's very, very, very small. And changes are very small that have taken place over the years. Now we look into the two other dimensions quickly. The inequalities between the rural and urban regions. Again, we find that the enrollment ratio in the rural areas have increased by four times between 1983 and 2009 and 10. While the enrollment ratio in urban areas has increased slightly around two times only, which means that again, rural population have improved, but still the enrollment ratio, absolute enrollment ratio is less than half of the enrollment ratio of the urban groups. So there is still a very high degree of inequality between rural and urban regions, but there is a rapid improvement over the years. I'm not presenting here, but I have seen the inequalities between different states also. And quite interestingly, the inequalities have increased between different states, measured by any simple statistical measure like coefficient of variation. has increased. So situation deteriorated, but the inequality coefficient increased. So the rural-urban inequalities are much higher, higher compared to other groups of population, though they also marginally declined between the several years here. The last group of inequalities that I have seen is between the rich and the poor. What we have is, that's the enrollment ratio, is we have the five income groups in the National Sample Survey, we call them expenditure groups. The poorest group is number one, and the richest group is number five. The enrollment ratio of the poorest group was 2% in 1993-94, which came down to 1.3 and then was 1.8% and then 5.2 in 2009 and 10. The enrollment ratio of the richest section of the population is 25.9% in 1993-94, which has increased to a whopping percent of 62%, which is comparable to the enrollment ratio in some of the richest countries of the world. The enrollment ratio in the United States is around 70-80%, and most of the European countries, rich European countries or OECD countries, is around 40-60%. So the enrollment ratio of the richest section of the society here is very high and comparable to the international levels, but the enrollment ratio of the bottom income groups, 2-5%, is the smallest ones in the whole country. So again, to sum it up, we find that there are very high degree of inequalities between the rich and the poor, particularly between the bottom income group and the top income group. And the bottom income group really suffered for quite some time. In fact, the enrollment ratio declined also, absolute ratio declined, while the absolute enrollment ratio of the richest income group increased by 11 points, which is a very significant improvement over the years. Now, these are, this is another indicator. I said I will not go much into detail, but this also is very clear. This is the fourth indicator that I referred to, the higher educational attainment ratio, which is the stock population, while the remaining three are flow variables. And if you look at any of those figures, these are inequality coefficients simply calculated as a ratio between the two sections of the population. The male-female enrollment ratio, the enrollment ratio of males over females, declined from 2.64 to 1.58, which is a very significant improvement. That's the reason why I said gender inequality has come down to a very, very significant extent in the country. Similarly, if you look at the enrollment ratio of scheduled tribe population in relation to the non-scheduled tribe population, it has declined from 6-4%. And the same is the case with non-scheduled and scheduled caste population. It declined from 5.4 to 2.89%. Now, these three, the male, female, the scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, and scheduled tribes and scheduled caste, we find a very, very significant levels of decline in terms of inequalities in education. I think the credit, perhaps at least partly, should be given to the policies that we have adopted during the last 50, 60 years in terms of reservations and other support programs, on which I'll comment a little bit later. But when you look at the enrollment ratio between the Hindus and Muslims, the decline is there, but very, very small, from 2.46 to 2.33 or 2.27 in the latest years. That's very small compared to the earlier ones. Earlier ones, in fact, you find a decline by nearly 50%, but here's a very, very small one. The inequality between urban and rural regions has also come down better than Hindus and Muslims, Hindus versus Muslims. But still an important issue. The last group is the richest group and the smaller and the poorest groups. There we find a very, very significant deterioration in the whole system. In fact, it's reverse. The inequality between the richest and the poorest has increased very significantly, in the sense that the top income group was 14 times better than the bottom income group in 1983, and today they are 22 times better than the bottom income group. So that's a very high degree of inequality. I'll not go further into the statistics, but I think these statistics are very, very important to note. I'll sum it up saying that higher education has grown very, very significantly in terms of quantitative numbers, of the total student numbers, in terms of millions of students, in terms of enrollment ratios. There has been a very significant growth. But this growth has not automatically resulted in reduction in inequalities between different sections of the population.
There has been reduction, but that is a very uneven reduction. Some groups benefited and some groups did not benefit much from that. The overall, still the overall rates of the weaker sections of the society at absolute levels are still very low. And all, in all cases, they are much lower than the counterparts. Whether it is scheduled caste, whether it is Muslims, or even with respect to girls, except in Kerala, the overall absolute enrollment ratios are. So the inequalities between transition rates are much smaller. So if you want to improve higher education, the implication is something different, that you have to really see that more and more students go into secondary education and get good quality secondary education. I will emphasize that further. The, with respect to the income groups, the improvement, absolute improvement is very, very small of the bottom sections of the society. There is some improvement in relative distribution or relative inequalities between gender, caste, religion, and regional groups, not much between income groups between the poor and the rich. Now, I'll try to make some policy kind of implications, highlight them. Among inequalities between different groups of population, inequalities by economic levels of households are higher than inequalities by other characteristics of population. And that's one point that I would like to highlight. The inequalities by gender, caste, religion, and between rural and urban are decreasing, but not at the same rate, and not at satisfactory levels also. Okay, let me go to the other one. Now, what we also find is inequalities between the poor and the rich are very, very systematic throughout the period that we have analyzed, in the sense that at all levels of education, starting from illiteracy, literacy levels, you find a very consistent, strong correlation between the level of economic level of the population and the enrollment ratios or the literacy rates in education at different levels. Very systematic, and you don't find any intersection of the lines if you make a graph curve. So at every level you find a higher, at every higher level of income you find a higher enrollment rate or higher education attainment rates. As a result, the overall meanness of schooling by the increasing levels of the population also that you could find. Rather, we have seen also that among the several factors which prohibit students from going into higher education sector, this was not secondary education, this was in higher education sector, we find that the most important factor is something like related to economic factors, including to supplement household income, to do jobs, and to do some domestic activities, including domestic occupational activities. So economic factors are the most important one. Now, that's the reason why I feel that perhaps we need to focus slightly more on inequalities by economic groups of population, and that has a very specific advantages. If you go into the economic groups of population, that cuts across religious groups, that cuts across caste groups, but because in every religion, in every caste, in every section of the society, there are the poorest sections of the society. That if you focus on that particular group of economically bottom groups, the whole arguments about creamy layer, et cetera, would disappear completely and make our public policy much more smoother. But what has happened over the years is in the policy discourses, gender inequalities have taken a lot of space, particularly during the last 20, 30 years, good and bad, I'm not really against it. And secondly, caste inequalities, particularly after 1970 with the Mandal and et cetera, where more and more castes are being brought into the category. But it's only recently, as I said, religious inequalities are being considered and the other inequalities are not taken at all. In fact, very, very low attention is paid between regional inequalities and economic groups of population. Now, we have the policies of reservations for a very long period. Now, I think it's a repetition. Go to the next one. Now, what we have to do is, whether how far, there is a lot of literature which clearly says that reservations have been very, very helpful in improving the enrollment rates. Research was done both by the Indians and also outsiders on Indian higher education and found that that's very important and that has paid very well. You skipped further? Okay, yeah. But as I said, The reservations are again confined to the scheduled caste, scheduled tribes, and the OBCs so far. And there is recently some discussion about reservations for Muslims that were still not, still in a fluid state of affairs. There is a need to shift the focus from, of course, we have not really have very strong policies of gender inequalities except some scholarships and free ships. Focus from gender inequalities, inequalities between castes, and inequality between religions to economically poor and also regionally backward regions of the country. That would really pay very high dividends. Second is inequalities in higher education cannot be discussed in isolation. As I said, they are critically dependent upon school education. If you want to have higher enrollment rates, and if there are no students coming from secondary education, there is, it's really a problem. So you have to really focus on secondary education, improve the quality of secondary education quite significantly. So, and it also makes a very, very, very clear point that not only education and simple education, but you also have to focus on quality education because you need to have really good quality education. There is no meaning of having universal education if it is a very poor quality. We need really universal quality education. Now, we have also been focusing, as I said, I referred to the four dimensions. The discussion was also, the presentation was also largely on enrollments. But the public policy is also only on enrollments, whether it is universal enrollments or with respect to higher education. With respect to primary education, elementary education, we are saying the first and most important goal is 100% enrollment rates. And it's only recently later we took up some other ideas, some other issues like dropouts. In higher education, the goal is still with respect to enrollment rates. The overall enrollment ratio has to be increased to 30%. That's a national goal. And it doesn't go really beyond those aspects. Now, what is given the developments that have taken place in the many universities and institutions of higher education, we also have to see how these children survive in the higher education systems, complete their higher education systems, and achieve and attain some reasonably good knowledge and skills from higher education. So, I mean, you find several kinds of suicides, several kinds of withdrawals, dropouts, forced dropouts, or which are also called in the literature as pushouts, are essentially because this, the support system in the higher education systems for many of these weaker sections are not adequate at all. We have been focusing on enrollments and nothing more than that. Once they're admitted, the government is happy that they're admitted, and that's it. It's also important to look at when some of the specific activities are being, specific incentives are being given, like hostels. You have to have really a holistic approach, integrated facilities for hostels, rather than saying in a university we have the hostels for SCs or we have the hostels for Muslims and we have the others. That ghettoism really will be problematic. I underline this particular point is in the sense that in the recent years some of the universities tried to do that. Have a special, because they got funds only for the scheduled caste hostels and they want to set up only scheduled caste hostels. That would really and strengthen social inequalities in the system to a very great extent, and that would be costly. We also have to shift from general higher education to quality higher education, which really focuses much more on this. The other point is in economics and public administration, we have the subsidies, public funding, public policies, which are general for higher education or general for everybody, and there are some specific. Now, it's the increasing concentration is going for specific scholarships, specific programs of incentives, specific subsidies, and there are strong plus points on both categories. But with respect to the specific subsidies that we have in the country as a whole, essentially because of our weak administrative capacity, the omissions and commissions, in the sense that the unfair exclusions from that category of beneficiaries is quite high. And unjustified inclusions are also quite high. So it's important that we formulate these specific subsidies in a very, very meaningful way. And if that's not possible, then you have really good universal subsidies everybody, available to everybody on a large scale. In fact, one of my strong arguments in my whole research is not confined just to this, is to have a good, strong public higher education system, which is heavily financed by the state, in fact, to so much extent if it is possible. Nowadays, it looks utopian, but 20 years ago, it was not a utopian thought. Even nowadays in some of the countries, it's not a utopian thought, it's being practiced, is to provide really good free higher education to everybody. And then the need for specific subsidies comes down, but still they can be very small specific subsidies. So it's very, very important to first to have some significant policy shifts from the current practices to the new some of the new developments that have taken place in the recent years. I'll stop here, and I'd like to thank you very much for the time given to me, and I hope some of these issues would be taken up in the following discussions, and I'm sure you would be able to contribute to make a sound and strong public policy debates. Thank you very much.